Biology is not perfect. It's close to perfection, maybe. But perfection, in a way, would mean death. In the next 20 minutes or so, I'll try to give you, hopefully, some insights in the current research that we are performing at the Max Delbruck Center in my so-called scientific genomics platform. And actually, we will try to analyze together, or at least to discuss some concepts, how we could scientifically analyze the process of aging. And maybe this has also some implications, actually, to understand actually the boundaries, also limitations of genetic engineering techniques to potentially inhibit aging. So to remind everyone of you, I mean, the fundamental unit in biology that we study is actually the cell. And it was here in Berlin in the 19th century that Rudolf Virchow founded actually cell biology and also the pathology based on the cell. And actually, our cellular nucleus is actually the location where we do have our genome, yeah, the DNA. And actually, it was in 1953 when this kind of iconographic photo has been taken with Jim Watson and Francis Crick. You see Francis Crick, 10 years older, explaining the younger one the structure of the DNA here. And I mean, that is kind of what you do see here is actually the pure chemistry of the DNA. And in the meantime, the years after, it has been discovered that the DNA is packed in our cellular nucleus in a very complex way. I mean, there's lots of structures which do play a role. In particular, our DNA is embedded actually in a matrix of proteins. And the proteins can be modified chemically, and this can have a number of influences on the accessibility of the DNA to produce an active genes or to activate genes and to produce the products, the RNA, the ribonucleic acids, and then finally the protein. And actually, there's also modification on the DNA which do play a major role, which is a DNA methylation, which is a specific kind of chemical modification of the DNA. And I mean, we all know, or we learned a lot, that the DNA is kind of our information storage device, in a way, our biological storage device. But actually, there's a number of regulatory processes which take place at the DNA. And so that's what is kind of illustrated on the right-hand side, that you do see that the pure DNA helix can have these methylation marks, so this chemical modification. And then you do see how the DNA is kind of embedded finally into our chromosomes in a very condensed way. I mean, just to mention, I mean, Jim Watson, I mean, the younger one here was more the communicative of the two, right? And he established a number of collaborations that made the discovery of the DNA possible. And he also had quite intense contacts with artists, and one of the most famous one was Salvador Dali. I mean, nowadays it looks like a kind of, to me, a little bit like a kitsch picture, but anyway, I mean, this is one of the first pictures which somehow was inspired by the structure of DNA, and you can see this painting in St. Petersburg in Florida now. And I mean, I'm not sure, I mean, anyway, the double helix is the only structure linking man to God. Okay, we leave this to you, how to interpret this. Maybe it's a little bit exaggerated. What is more important for the rest of my today's talk is maybe this kind of picture which you do see here. And this displays the so-called Waddington's epigenomic landscape. And I told you that the DNA and the surrounding proteins are highly modified. And these modifications can, in a way, determine the regulation of the whole genome, in a way. And so depending on signals, incoming signals, intrinsic signals, but also external signals, like for example, stress. I mean, stress can have an influence on cells and finally also on the modifications of our DNA or the surrounding proteins. And this can then lead to kind of different decision. And so depending maybe on some probabilities or also on just some kind of deterministic mechanisms, I mean, there is kind of different possibilities at the beginning, but finally the marble may end up here in one of these valleys, and then it will stick there and will not come out of this anymore. So in a way, there's the idea that epigenetic modifications can somehow influence our DNA in such a way that you may finally be trapped in such a valley, which could be a disease state where it would be very difficult to reprogram our DNA in a way that you could become healthy. So today we'll focus on cardiac aging, but first of all, I just want to make you aware of something which for a developmental biologist is very clear. So we'll start rather with the development of the heart to understand actually some major steps in heart development or in development in general, and then we'll speak about the degradation process, the aging process. And I just want to remind you actually that in the early days of fertilization, in the human fertilized egg, after 3 weeks, the fertilized egg has already developed a heart structure. And this is somehow very important because you need to kind of deliver lots of molecules to the various cells. So the bigger the egg becomes, there's more and more cells, and you need kind to develop a bloodstream actually to be able to deliver all the molecules required to the different cells. So in the very early phase of the fertilized egg, we have kind of this heart, this very early heart developed. And so it was already in old Greek times when this has been discovered, and the German word for this is der springende Punkt. Yeah, that's how the heart was called here. And so actually what is important, I mean, there's been already in old Greek times a lot of philosophy. For us today, it's just important that, I mean, imagine that everything is based kind of on matter, on our atoms, on our molecules, on our large biomolecules, but all this is kind of matter. And finally, in biology, I mean, we could discuss this here in more detail maybe in the break, but I mean, all this leads finally to morphology, to a structure. So from a kind of a molecular chaos, we finally end up with structures like the heart, like an embryo, like a human being finally. Yeah. So I mean, and that's a miracle. How is this being organized? And since the development of molecular biology after the discovery of the structure of DNA in 1953, I mean, there has been kind of, even a dogma that everything is kind of programmed in our DNA. And so this somehow implies kind of a very deterministic view. Today, I would just say that, I mean, we have kind of stable information in our DNA. But there's also dynamics. I mean, the DNA itself is quite static. It's just something which is in our cellular nucleus, but then we use this information to produce required biomolecules to finally build up a living system. So this is what I would call the more unstable information. So for example, the modifications of the DNA, the methylation, or also the modifications of the proteins surrounding the DNA. And that is kind of more unstable, but also dynamic information which is stored there. And we do need, obviously, dynamics to produce something which we would consider as a living system. And then there is, I mean, on the level of transcriptomes, even more transient information. So that we produce RNA and also proteins, which finally lead to functions.
that we can somehow assemble biomolecules together, which then in a cooperative manner do execute certain functions. And what is also very important is actually the spatial information. Where do molecules in a single cell do meet each other? And this is also just a picture from a quite famous textbook from Müller and Hassel in developmental biology, that in the fertilized egg already, there is kind of predetermined way to finally produce a whole organism. And this is somehow predetermined by the location of mRNA in such a fertilized egg. So there's a gradient always in these eggs, which finally lead to kind of structures that you have kind of what is the upper part and the lower part, for example, of a human being, what is more the front side and the back side and so on. So all this is kind of predetermined by the spatial information. So, I mean, all this is kind of concepts which are required, I mean, to understand how life is built up or a living system is being built up. Aging is kind of an opposite process. It's kind of a process of degradation instead of building something up. And the question is, I mean, and our focus in our lab is to work on cardiac aging. And the reason for that is that also the MDC has a focus on cardiovascular diseases. And this not only by chance, but because cardiovascular diseases are the major cause of death in Western societies, actually. And I mean, this has already been discussed previously here, is, I mean, what does change during aging? Is there kind of a program which is underlying the aging process, which is somehow triggered and then in a deterministic way is being educated so that an organism does age? Or is this more a random process? And I mean, one thing, and that is kind of against the argumentation of many of these kind of genetic or gene engineering ideas, is actually that we all have to be aware that in biochemistry or in chemistry in general, there is no process which is for 100% perfect. Yeah, there's always kind of noise. We know it from organic chemistry, where chemists can very nicely define research kind of reaction conditions, for example, but he never gains a 100% output. And this is obviously even much more complicated in the human body. And I mean, but already on a very basic level, a chemical reaction or a biochemical reaction is not a process which is for 100% perfect. And this is, for example, also true when a cell divides into new cells, and that then we also have to replicate, for example, the information in our DNA. And but on the other hand, it is also kind of nice that in biochemical reaction there is kind of certain noise level, background noise level, because this can also lead to advantages, so that a cell could more flexibly react to changing environments, for example. And so this implies that, I mean, this is in a way also an advantage. And something which is also very much forgotten, but I mean, we are surrounded by oxygen, and in a way, oxidation is one of the underlying process anyway, a chemical process which leads to aging. And it's quite forgotten, but there's a so-called redox environment which becomes more and more oxidative during life and thereby leads also to degradation by oxidation of molecules. One term which is also very often mentioned in the context of aging is entropy. And entropy is kind of a process which describes the dissipation of energy, but we could also say in our case of structure. So we may have something which is highly organized here, and the process of entropy finally leads to yeah, to a degradation of this kind of structure. And this is the underlying principle is the second law of thermodynamics of this. So now what we do at the moment at in the lab, I mean, we wanted to understand actually how various cell types in our heart do change in terms of their expression and in terms of the variability from cell to cell during aging. And we also want to know which genes are in particular involved in this, and also which genes show highest variability from cell to cell to understand better the process of degradation of organization of cells in the various tissues of the heart. And for this, we use a quite novel and still quite unique approach, which is to analyze DNA and RNA on the level of single cells. It's so-called single cell genomics. And we do analyze mainly the RNAs, functional nucleic acids, but we also do analyze the DNA modifications, the DNA methylation, and we also look for those sites which we call open chromatin, which is the active sites on our genome. And we analyzed actually hearts derived from young and from old mice, and we looked in every individual cell types of the hearts on the level of single cells, how are the genes activated and how does this change over life. And for this, we use quite a new microfluidics, microdroplet-based technologies, which are quite advanced, and we use DNA sequencing machines to finally read out the nucleic acids in a high throughput manner. And by the way, we just purchased a very new machine here, which you see over there, which allows you also to sequence an entire human genome with so-called 30-fold coverage, so with high quality, for around €1,200. And so this makes it quite attractive. And in the US, actually, there's many people who use this technology also to analyze their own genome. And I mean, it's kind of, by the way, has anyone sequenced here his or her own genome so far? Only one. In the US, I think every second one would wave their hand with a similar audience. So I mean, actually, this is, we don't have to understand every detail of this here, but it somehow shows you that we can then display also in a very colorful way the various cell types that we do detect here. And then we can start with a number of analyses which tell us about the genes which are being differentially expressed, which are highly variable from cell to cell, and so on. But we cannot go into the details of this. In a way, there is some computational analysis which do show in this figure here, for example, that in the older hearts, and in particular in some cell types and cell states, we do see kind of certain functions which are more pronounced in the older heart compared to the younger hearts. So this shows already, for example, that there's a lot of inflammation or much more inflammatory processes being active in the old hearts, and in particular cell types, like the fibroblasts, for example, in the heart of old mice. And what we can also analyze is, without our methods, to also see which of the cell states of the cell types, in this case of the fibroblasts, are very active. So this is kind of indicated by these arrows here, where you see where there's high dynamics, where these cells are being expressed very actively in the old state. And what is very interesting, where we have these kind of high dynamics, we also see high entropy. So maybe you still remember the concept with this very structured figure and then all these dots kind of being around. So what this tells you here is actually that in those states where I just showed you before, that there is high dynamics, that in this case we do see that there's a lot of kind of degradation going on, and we can, that's a nice feature about this, quantify this. So we then have relative quantification, and we can really see in which states, and this is, for example, these two states, we have a statistically significant change in the entropy. So conclusions, there's a number of cells being inflamed in the old state. And we do see that a number of cells, there's more cells and more genes related to inflammation which are activated. And that we do see that there's high entropy and a lot of degradation of functionally and structurally relevant genes. And what we finally analyze is actually that, and that's something that I did not stress too much, but I shall do it now, is that the mice that were kept in the cage, and the young were around 10 weeks or so, and the old 18 months, they lived very nicely there. I mean, they were completely healthy. And what we somehow observed here was really kind of the intrinsic aging. And you also mentioned that epigenetics can play a certain role, and our underlying hypothesis is that during replication and replication, we also then have to remethylate and remodify the newly synthesized DNA in the new cells, and thereby we always produce errors. And this then accumulates from generation of cells, which may divide in days or weeks or something like this. And thereby we do accumulate actually then also kind of errors. And what it finally, and there is some evidence already in some of the data, that we do see a much more fuzzy accumulation of DNA methylation in the DNA of the old mice. So finally, I mean, we do see trends for de-imprinting of genes in the old mice. And this leads me to the last figure here. Again, this Weddington epigenomic landscape. And you could somehow make an analogy that during aging, maybe all these structures here, which we do see in this landscape, may be flattened in a way, that the marble would somehow not find any valley at all, really, and that finally we would dissipate all the epigenomic information if we would go ahead and ahead and ahead with the DNA methylation. And this is kind of interesting because Holger Hein, friend and colleague in Barcelona, he sequenced some years ago actually centenarians and also the DNA methylation of centenarians. And he found also out that, I mean, that the very old people have already quite fuzzy methylation patterns, which were not as defined anymore compared to the young. So in a way, our underlying hypothesis is that a lot of the aging processes we do see have to do with deorganization processes on the cellular level, so that the synchrony between cells is not guaranteed anymore. And this then has a number of physiological implications like health decline and finally also leading to death. And so this also shows you, and what I want to convey here today is that we should always keeping in mind that it is nice to have a deterministic understanding or a mechanistic understanding, but what I hope that I could show you a little bit here today is that it's not as easy that you just use a toolkit and then you can reverse everything, because in a way, I mean, you always have to deal with, in living systems, with some fuzziness, and if this is not there anymore, you would finally start with a process which finally would manifest a certain process. And biology is not perfect.
It's close to perfection, maybe, but perfection in a way would mean death. And so, I mean, a perfect crystal is a dead system, and so that is not what a living system should be, and also should not be considered. Thank you very much.